Welcome to another video in the series about the C7000 compiler. This is the second of two videos which explain the most commonly used compiler options. My name is George Mock, and I'm your guide. This video does not discuss all of the compiler options. In part one, we discussed the options related to getting good performance. In this video, part two, we will discuss options related to understanding compiler output and runtime model. Why might you need to look at the output of the compiler? It turns out improving performance of software pipeline loops typically requires viewing the assembly code the compiler generates. The options that I'm about to walk through make it easier to understand that assembly code. And there will be more details about understanding that assembly code and how you can act on it and that sort of thing in the videos about software pipelining. I will demonstrate the options related to understanding compiler output by interacting with the compiler from the command line. I know that's not how customers typically interact with the compiler, but it's a good way to do this demonstration. It's a really nice way to add an option and show the effect it has very quickly. So the first thing I want to do is show you the source file we're using here. Nothing terribly interesting about it. As long as it does a little bit more than nothing, it's good enough for this demonstration. Feel free at any time during this part of the video to just pause anytime you want to take a closer look at something. That's really the best way to go about that. So there's the source file. This is the contents of the directory right now. It's just got that file in it. So the first thing we'll try and do is build it with op level 3, because I keep going on about this is the level of optimization most customers use. Let's give that a go. And look at the directory again. Hey, all we have is an object file. We want to look at the assembly file. Well, it turns out you don't get the assembly file by default. Okay, you have to add an option for that, and that is --keep ASM. This will tell the compiler, hey, keep the assembly file for me because I want to look at it. Right, and there it is, the assembly file. So let's get a look at that assembly file. I'll use the notepad editor because it's a very simple editor. It's good for demonstrations like this. And here it is. I can understand how this would be a bit daunting at first. Please understand you don't need to know all of these details. When you're actually working with the file, you focus on a few things, and it's actually pretty straightforward to get the information you need and then act on it. So don't be too worried about that right now. I do want you to understand that things that begin with a dot, like this one right here, those are assembler directives. They are different than, say, these guys. Those are instructions that actually execute on the device. And I also want to focus your attention on all these directives that begin .dw something. Those are dwarf debug directives, and there's a lot of them. They're throughout the file. There's dwarf debug directives running around, not in that particular screenful. But yeah, there's quite a few of them, a lot of them at the end. And they take up a lot of space in the file, and they can make it a little bit difficult to work with it. So a good way to tell the compiler, hey, I don't want to see those, is you add an option called --sim debug:none. And this is an option you use only in this particular circumstance where you're going to look at the assembly file, because you don't want to use this option really in any other circumstance, because it means you cannot debug the code. But we do want to look at the assembly file. We don't plan to debug this particular code. Let's go ahead and give that a try. And then let's bring Notepad back up and see the difference. Now all the .dw something directives are gone, and the file is quite a bit shorter and easier to work with now. Next, I'd like you to consider, wouldn't it be great if I could somehow associate assembly instructions like these with the C code that they came from? Well, it turns out there's a compiler option dedicated to that purpose. Let me take Notepad down, go back to the command line, and what I'm going to do is remove keepASM and, oops, wrong command, there we go, this one. I'm going to remove keepASM and put in this option. I say source interlist, but you spell it that way. Source interlist implies within it keepASM, so the assembly file will be kept, but it does an additional step. What is that? Let's take a look. First, let's run the compiler. Bring Notepad back up. And I want you to notice that there's statements like this in there now. Okay, these are additional comments added by the compiler to help you understand. You know, these comments relate to these assembly language instructions and so on. You'll notice they are not the same lines as you wrote in your C code. The higher the optimization level that you use, the more different these interlisted comments will be. And remember, we're using op level 3 right now, okay? Now, the next thing I want to show you is something called this right here, we call it the software pipeline information comment block, because it's, you know, it's a block comment. And this is where you're going to be, where you're going to focus most of the time when you're looking at assembly code. You know, some of these lines can be really important with regard to what the software pipeline is and is not doing and what you might do to improve the performance. So there is a way to get an even more verbose version of the software pipeline information, and that is to use another option. Imagine that, another option. Okay, I'm going to add it here, and it's called dash dash debug software pipeline. Let's give this a try and see what happens. Notepad again. Alright, let's go down to where the software pipeline comment. Okay, so now it's got a lot more information in it. Alright, that wasn't there before. This register usage table, that wasn't there before. And so on. I'm not going to explain all these things in detail during this particular video. But I will say this. The compiler version that we're using right now, and you can see it right here, is 4.1.0.lts. Starting with this version of the compiler, the default software pipeline information comment block has most of what you need most of the time, and therefore starting with this version of the compiler, the option debug software pipeline becomes less interesting. However, there are some people who are still using older versions of the compiler, and for them, the software pipeline, the default software pipeline information comment block is missing some things that can sometimes be important, and so for those customers you do need to know about the option debug software pipeline. Next, I want to show you an additional file that will give you additional information from the compiler, but it's not the assembly file, so I want to cause Notepad to go away, and I'll show you the option. Bring the compiler command, oops, wrong one, this one, and the additional option is dash dash gen opt info equals 2. Turns out that this is going to generate yet another file. The argument 2 says give me the most verbose version of it. And this is the additional file, file.nfo. Let's get a quick look at it. Okay, so here it is. It's not particularly interesting in this case because, you know, this is, we're starting with just a toy example input file. It's just got one function in it. But there is some information that's in this optimizer information file. That's why it's got, you know, the word optimizer here. That can be interesting and useful in some cases. So I went through a lot of options during that demonstration. I'm going to do a quick review of them all in one place right here. Dash dash keep ASM tells the compiler to keep the assembly language file, don't delete it. Dash dash simdebug colon none removes the debug directives. Dash dash source interlist adds comments to the assembly language to help you associate this, the instructions with the C code. Debug software pipeline makes the software pipeline information comment block more verbose. And gen op info equals two creates yet another file with the extension .nfo that has information about optimizations that were performed. Now we change to a discussion of the options related to the runtime model. Why are the runtime model options interesting? Well, these options tell the compiler the details of the DSP that the code will execute on. It is rare to set them manually. There are two main use cases, two main ways they tend to come in. One is you'll copy them from whatever software development kit you're using. You'll get an example from there and you'll use those build options that are appropriate for the particular DSP you're going to execute on. Another way to do it is when you create a new project in CCS, you tell it, you know, this is the system on a chip DSP that you're using, and that in turn causes CCS to set these options for you automatically. Those options have to exactly match the DSP that you're running on, and there's no way for the compiler to verify that this is correct. It's a case where the compiler has to just blindly do what the user says to do. But because you see these options used in your build, it is good to know the basics of what these options are about. The first of the runtime model options to discuss is dash dash silicon version equals some value, and these are the values that are supported as of this recording. This is how the compiler knows exactly which variant of the C7000 DSP the code will run on. Over time, this list will grow longer, more are going to be added. The second one was dash dash MMA version equals value. These are the values that are supported, but they're limited in the sense that one can only be combined with silicon version 7100, for instance, and so on and so forth in this table. But for any silicon version, you can say MMA version is disallowed, which means the compiler should not use any of the MMA instructions when that is the setting of the option dash dash MMA version. I will close this video with two references. The first one is to this web address, which is a lot to type in, so another way to do it is to do an internet search for C7000 compiler. With all the search engines I've tried, this web address is the first result that's returned. Regardless of how you get there, this is the homepage for the C7000 compiler. It's where you can download it, access the manuals, and more details like that. The second reference is to e2e.ti.com. This is where you can ask any question about any TI product, including the C7000 compiler. If that question is related to the compiler, it will be answered by me. Thank you for watching this video in the series about the C7000 compiler.